Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 11127 in the name of Siobhan Brown on cashback for communities. I'd invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite Siobhan Brown to speak to and move the motion, Minister, for around 11 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many members will already be familiar with the Cashback for Communities programme and the work it delivers in their communities, and some may have even visited projects in their area to see the work firsthand. Cashback is unique to Scotland. The programme takes funds recovered from criminals under the proceeds of Criminal Act 2002 and returns them to the communities. The funding is used to deliver a range of community projects and activities to support children and young people aged between 10 and 25. Since its inception in 2008, the Scottish Government have delivered five phases of the cashback programme, committing up to £130 million over that time. This investment has provided over 2.5 million activities and opportunities and has supported more than 1.3 million young people as it has grown in breadth and diversity over the years. In its early days, the programme funded investment in football facilities and playing fields to divert youth away from antisocial behaviour. It's now developed into a multifaceted programme of activities that range from intensive one-to-one support for young people and their families, including counselling for trauma, through to skills development, creative arts development, volunteering and employability work. The diversity and accessibility of the program is greater than ever, with Cashback offering projects to young people in every one of our local authorities. It supports young people of all backgrounds to engage in projects that help to build their confidence, encourage positive life choices, and raise their aspirations. Presiding Officer, today we publish the 2022-2023 Cashback for Communities Impact Report, which is the final annual report from Phase 5 of the cashback, which ran from April 2020 to March 2023. Almost all of Phase 5 was delivered during the global COVID-19 pandemic period. And this was a time of unprecedented upheaval and challenge, where young people's lives faced immense disruption and uncertainty, and all the projects were also impacted. Year 3, which was from April 2022 to March 2023, covers a period where lockdown restrictions finally ended and young people started to rebuild their lives. Against this context, the 22-23 impact report shows that the programme still achieved remarkable outcomes for children and for young people. This is a testament to the dedication of all those involved in delivering the cashback programme. Projects that would traditionally have been delivered face-to-face and inside a venue became very difficult during COVID, and it was a real challenge to find activities that could be offered to young people as access to venues and facilities were unavailable due to the social distancing restrictions. Many organisations piloted online delivery and outdoor approaches to ensure that thousands of potentially isolated young people could be reached and supported during that time. Where this was not possible, for example, projects working with young people in prisons, alternative creative approaches were used to keep in touch with participants, such as broadcasting messages to prisoners using prison radio. The impact of the pandemic was far-reaching, and cashback organisations responded to the immediate needs of many children, young people and families, including, for example, by delivering food parcels. Phase 5 organisations are to be commended for their response to the pandemic at a time when their own organisations were also dealing with challenges of sickness and furloughed staff. Up to £19 million was committed to support the Phase 5 cashback programme. The impact report shows us the positive benefits of the project funded during this phase. There were 28,060 young people participated in Year 3 activities, with 78% of the participants being from the 30% most deprived communities. Young people achieved a wide range of outcomes. Over 21,000 reported increased confidence and improved their health and well-being. Nearly 17,000 reported positive behavioural changes and achieved positive destinations that included staying on at school, further education, training and employment. And nearly 15,000 said they felt less inclined to take part in antisocial behaviour. Over 4,000 also undertook 115,000 hours of volunteering. We can all celebrate these positive achievements, and it is direct from those young people that we get some of the most powerful endorsements for the program. One reflection from one young person about their time in the program is, and I quote, "I'm just keeping my head down. Since I've got this job, I haven't been hanging about, and it's kept me busy. If I hadn't got this job, I'd probably be still kicking about getting into trouble." The feedback from families is also a positive one. For example, one parent observed, "I've never seen him so confident. He is quite happy being independent at the session now and getting involved with activities and making friends." In addition, Presiding Officer, 97% of other stakeholders, such as teachers and project workers, perceived improvements in wellbeing indicators, with 92% reporting a reduction in risk-taking behaviour. The incredible work of our cashback-funded partners is founded on their total commitment to understanding the needs of the young people that they engage with. Phase 5 partners were the first group of cashback organisations to embed children's rights and wellbeing into the cashback program. All 24 cashback organisations reviewed their work against the principles of the UNCRC to ensure that the needs and the rights of the children and the young people remained central to the program. And the children and the young people themselves were active participants in that process. They were also involved in shaping Phase 5 projects and providing feedback to help frame our next phase. We surveyed over 850 cashback participants during Phase 5, and the findings were clear. Most of the participants the proceeds of crime should be reinvested into those communities most impacted, and an overwhelming positive response to the value, wide-ranging and easy accessibility of cashback projects, which were viewed by participants as highly inclusive. Young people placed most value on mental health, particularly in relation to confidence, anxiety and social interaction, alongside acquiring new skills and experiences and improving support networks through one-to-one support and guidance from trusted and experienced mentors and staff. In several instances, young people reported that this enabled them to stop and reduce offending behaviour, drug and alcohol abuse, self-harming, and rebuild positive family relationships. Volunteering and community connectivity was also highly valued by the participants. I hope members will take time to view the 2022-23 impact report in full and will agree that it demonstrates that the cashback is a highly impactful program and worth every penny invested. A full evaluation of Phase 5 will be published before the end of this year, and it's important that we do this at the end of each three-year phase to ensure that the work we fund remains relevant and adds value to our young people and has a positive impact on our communities. Presiding Officer, the end of Phase 5 this year also marks the beginning of the next phase of Cashback for Communities program. And Phase 6 will run from April 2023 to March 2026, with a further commitment of up to £20 million. This significant investment from money recovered from the proceeds of crime reflects our confidence in the program. Each phase is underpinned by a robust application process where organisations are able to submit project proposals. Successful applicants were awarded grant funding for a three-year period. Phase 6 was the most competitive round of funding so far, with the program significantly oversubscribed. Unfortunately, we were not able to fund every proposal, and so only the very strongest applications were successful, and I'm sure they'll be as successful as the previous projects. I recently had the pleasure of meeting all 29 of the Phase 6 cashback partners to learn about the range of work that is planned for the next 3 years, and I was really impressed by the strength of the projects on offer and the passion and the professionalism of all these organisations. The focus for Phase 6 projects is to support young people most at risk of being involved in antisocial behaviour offending and reoffending towards or into positive destinations. Fund projects will provide support for young people, parents and families impacted by adverse childhood experiences and trauma, support young people to improve their health, mental health and wellbeing, and also support people and families and communities most affected by crime. The latest cohort of projects is both strong and diverse. in addition to traditional youth work, sporting activities, employability, culture and arts project, we have strengthened the range of options available to support girls and young women, young carers, and also homeless young people. We've also increased our commitment to diversity, investing in key work to promote children's rights, racial equality, and disability. The cashback also aims to include support for young people who have been in conflict with the justice system. This morning, I was pleased to visit the VOW cashback project delivered by Police Scotland in partnership with the charity Aid and Abet. This intensive support project aims to remove young people from the criminal justice system and support them into positive destinations. The collaboration between police officers and the peer mentors is a fantastic model for building trust with young people and help them make positive choices. It was a real privilege to meet those involved in delivering the project as one of the young, and also meet one of the young people who has really benefited from it in the last few months. Previous feedback from one young person who engaged with the project during phase five is testament to the impact of the program, saying, "Had I not met the VOW project, I have no idea where I would be with my drinking, but I believe I would have continued to escalate further into criminality and self-destruction." Presiding Officer, the cashback project work delivered in these and similar settings across the country is helping young people to rebuild their lives, family connections and relationships with the community. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I could ask you to move the motion, please.
Oh, sorry, move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Minister, we are quite tight for time across the rest of the afternoon, just to advise you at this stage. Anybody that hasn't pressed their button but wanting to speak should do so now. And I call on Russell Finlay to speak to and move amendment 11127.2 of the 7 minutes.
Mr. Thank you. I begin by saying that we agree with the Scottish Government motion on cashback for communities, and I hope they find agreement with our constructive amendment. Drug dealers prey on the weak and the vulnerable. They inflict misery and death across Scotland. Their dirty money poisons society and the economy. The Proceeds of Crime Act was groundbreaking when it came into force in 2004. The police were excited at the prospect of this powerful new weapon. The crime gangs were in a panic. The rules, we were told, had changed. Crime would no longer pay. Working as a journalist, I bought it. Dirty fortunes could be seized on the less onerous civil standard of proof, on the balance of probabilities. Crucially, a criminal conviction would not be required. In the crosshairs were the besuited bosses who do not get their own manicured hands dirty, those who stay arm's length from the drugs that kill countless numbers of our people, those who never personally wield the knife or fire the gun. The first significant Scottish case became a protracted farce, a decade-long quagmire of legal attrition, and in the end, the dirty fortune was whittled down to nothing, having only lined the pockets of lawyers. This exposed the limitations of the new law and resulted in a fundamental change of direction. The new focus was instead for proceeds of crime to be pursued after a criminal conviction had been secured. Of course, every single penny snatched from criminals and ploughed back into our communities is welcome. There's no question about that. Many young people across Scotland have benefited from the £130 million of dirty money distributed by Cashback for Communities. Their work makes a positive difference to so many young lives. However, the cost of organised crime in Scotland is not counted in the millions, but in the billions. The early optimism of proceeds of crime has become blunted, and every passing week we see examples of this in the courts. Cases in which vast criminal fortunes have been generated only for a fraction to be subject to a confiscation order. Take the international drug dealer James White from Glasgow. The Crown Office says with confidence, based on the evidence, that he made £126 million. That's £126,241,001.29 to be precise, from killing countless Scots. So a single drug dealer has made the same amount as the entire 15-year spend of cashback for communities. So how much of White's drug money do the authorities hope to get their hands on? The answer is just over £118,000. That represents less than 0.1%. This example, and many others, I hope, will persuade the government to look again at this legislation. Will there be time?
It's up to the member whether he takes the intervention.
I'm going to see how I get on first. Thank you. Okay.
Christine Graham, briefly.
I hope it's helpful because I think you make a very important point. And it may be too complicated to answer here and now, but I would like to know what one can do, what's missing in recouping that extra money that you refer to. What would you suggest this review should do?
Russell Finlay.
I'll attempt to come on to that, but there's a lot to say, so yes, thank you. Criminals now regard proceeds of crime as a form of retrospective taxation, essentially an occupational hazard. But even then, once served with a confiscation order, they often refuse to pay up. Last year, £12 million of confiscation orders were unpaid and unknown sums have been written off. This is wrong and should also form part of any widespread review. A renewed and a robust proceeds of crime law could yield even more money for our communities. Presiding Officer, I have a specific concern relating to cashback for communities and amateur boxing. Many boxing clubs are great forces for good. They're at the heart of communities, they're run by decent people who support young people and help keep them out of trouble. But they tell me of significant infiltration by organised crime. We see the same in professional boxing with the Kinahan cartel and their Scottish associates. Real boxing people despise this contamination of their sport, which brings me back to James White. This £126 million drug dealer sought legitimacy by coaching kids at a Glasgow boxing club. This same club has received money from Cashback for Communities, which seeks to divert youths from crime. It would be perverse that money seized from drug dealers should end up being returned to drug dealers. And I therefore urge the Scottish Government to conduct an audit of where this money ends up. Our amendment also calls for the Scottish Government to update its serious organised crime strategy. I've got very little time left, but I believe that much more needs to be done to tackle the flow of laundered drugs money into society. One area of particular concern is sport, not just in boxing, but also professional football. Just like boxing, good people in football have no time for the exploitation of the national game by drug dealers. Police Scotland previously issued a video warning young players about organised criminals posing as football agents. Prominent lawyers and former players provide a veneer of respectability. This is a significant problem, and there's also evidence that drugs money has seeped into the ownership and control of senior football clubs. So, in football, much of this is an open secret, but it appears that no one's willing or able to talk about it publicly. In 7 minutes, it's impossible to go into sufficient level of detail, but we should all be in agreement that in Scotland, crime should not pay. And today, that is not something I've got any confidence in saying. And I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I now call Katie Clark to speak to and move amendment 127.1 up to 6 minutes. Ms. Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm pleased to follow Russell Finlay, who makes a powerful case for a review, and to open this debate on behalf of Scottish Labour. We support this programme and efforts to work with young people, direct them to positive destinations and reduce reoffending. Cashback for Communities is a continuation of a scheme to reinvest the proceeds of crime first established by Scottish Labour in government in 2006, and that in turn drew from the framework set out in the Proceeds of Crime Act 2002, introduced and passed by the Labour government of that time. Two decades on, with the challenges of Tory austerity and the pandemic, there's absolutely no doubt that youth services are in a sorry state in Scotland. But young people, as we know, still face many challenges, and the diversionary activities that the Minister have spoken about are a clear component of any functioning justice system, and indeed providing alternatives to those that might be drawn into crime. The antisocial behaviour on display at the weekend testifies to that. Prevention of crime and better outcomes for those at risk of involvement must be a crucial part of addressing criminal behaviour in the first place. There must be greater clarity on what metrics the Scottish Government are using to measure the success of the various activities that are being supported by this scheme. I note that these aren't set out in the latest evaluation report for 2020 to 2023, published on the Cashback for Communities website, and so feedback from the Minister on this point would be welcome. Other than assessments of positive destinations, it's not clear whether there's concrete evidence to conclude that these specific projects are reducing crime. I'm also unclear on how organisations are selected, so it would be helpful if the Minister perhaps could say more on that. Many of the organisations funded are national charities. However, I think all of us in our constituencies will know of schemes where there are local groups which receive valuable funding. In North Ayrshire, for example, as well as getting the benefits of national governing bodies for football and rugby, who've received hundreds of thousands of pounds between them, there are a number of local sports projects that are supported. But it would be good to know whether smaller grassroots organisations, say, for example, council-run youth clubs, tend to bid for grants. The sums awarded to a relatively small number of large organisations clearly have benefit. However, almost all of these types of projects are now delivered by the third sector. Of course, charities and not-for-profit organisations aren't subject to freedom of information coverage despite receiving public money, albeit that those funds are recovered from criminal activities rather than taxation. It's therefore more important that the Scottish Government provides transparency, as that will not only be of public benefit, but also allow us to better guide projects and assess outcomes for the young people that they support. I would also like to make the point that the amount of funds that are recovered to support these projects in the first place are relatively small. I understand that £7 million was recovered in the last financial year measured, which was 2020 to 2021. But the Scottish Government's own assessment back in 2017 was that organised crime cost the Scottish economy £2 billion a year. Russell Finlay has already spoken in detail of the fact that one... Yes, I'd be happy to.
Keith Brown. Can I thank the member for taking intervention? And she'll be aware of the cross-border nature of much of this crime, including in particular the supply of drugs to Scotland from road and rail in England. Given that, does she agree that if the UK government was to take the same approach as the Scottish government in terms of cash back for communities and apply that to some of the proceeds of crime that they had, that could provide benefit to the people of Scotland? And if she does agree, will she agree to write with me to the UK government proposing that change?
Katie Clark.
I'd be very, very happy to write with Keith Brown. He clearly has a huge amount of experience to draw upon, and I'm sure he's absolutely correct in what he's saying. As Russell Finlay was saying, one person from an organised crime group in Scotland made more than a reported £126 million, yet only 0.1% of that was confiscated. And I'm absolutely clear that these organised criminal gangs do not stop at borders, so the more cross-border cooperation, the better. So I would welcome clarity on what steps are being taken and indeed what dialogue ministers are having with the UK government, but also with Police Scotland and the Crown Office to ensure that more money is recovered in cases that could potentially support community projects, and if the Minister could outline what work is being done to increase the monies recovered. As I said, I think that Russell Finlay made a powerful case for a review. However, I would like to make it very clear to the Minister that Scottish Labour supports this scheme, but I hope that she will address the issues and concerns that are being raised in this debate. And finally, I would like to move the amendment in my name, which speaks of the importance of restorative justice practices, and ask that the Minister also responds on that point.
Thank you very much. I now call on Beatrice Wishart for up to 4 minutes. Ms. Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak on the Cashback for Communities programme today. Scottish Liberal Democrats believe that reducing crime involves a coordinated approach across sectors, from tackling homelessness and offering more education and training opportunities to more outreach youth services and stronger action to help recovery from and prevention of drug and alcohol abuse. Cashback for Communities supports organisations that are working to help achieve crime reduction. Money recovered under the Proceeds of Crime Act is reinvested into organisations working to support young people at risk of being involved in antisocial behaviour, offending or re-offending. The 29 partner organisations in this phase of the programme cover a range of projects across Scotland, as others have highlighted, and examples include Edinburgh Young Carers, providing mental health support, core skills development and respite activities for children and young people caring for a parent affected by alcohol or substance abuse in the most deprived areas of the capital. And Starcatchers, working with young parents in Fife living in areas of socio-economic deprivation to improve mental health and social and emotional well-being. Working with young people who have been impacted by adverse childhood experiences from across Scotland, the Ocean Youth Trust Scotland develops young people's confidence, resilience and teamwork skills through outdoor education and SAIL training, which gives young people the opportunity for personal development through the experience of a lifetime. In my own constituency of Shetland, Cashback for Communities funding supported extracurricular programmes focused on road safety. These are just some examples of the positive impact that funding from Cashback for Communities can have by supporting projects that build capacity, resilience and confidence of young people, reducing crime through working with communities. However, one scheme can't be looked at in isolation. The reduction of funding of youth services threatens any good work undertaken through this programme. Holistic efforts to tackle crime requires visible and viable youth support services with reliable funding. Presiding Officer, if I may, I would like to highlight the work of a Shetland charity that I believe fits with the ethos of Cashback for Communities. Dogs Against Drugs works in two ways. Trained dog handlers work with drug detection dogs to seize and prevent illegal drugs and associated cash from entering Shetland. And at the same time, the charity works with local schools to deliver education aimed at preventing drug use, reaching 1,800 pupils this year so far. They also work with the Moving On project, supporting vulnerable young people. In 2022, the charity seized almost £30,000 in drugs cash, which was seized as proceeds of crime, and this year to date it seized £14,000. Despite their work with young people, the charity was unable to apply for funding from Cashback for Communities in this phase due to the way the criteria is laid out. The Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs met with me earlier this year to discuss the charity, and I again thank her for her time. And I'd like to stress the importance of the work Dogs Against Drugs undertakes in Shetland. Disrupting the illegal drug supply chain and delivering crucial awareness-raising courses in school. So it seems reasonable that as the charity seizes cash from the illegal drugs trade, that they should receive some funding back into their work. I understand the current phase of Cashback for Communities runs until March 2026. So when the Scottish Government's determining possible future criteria of the programme, I would ask that consideration might be given as to how an organisation like Dogs Against Drugs might meet any new conditions. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Wishart. We now move to the open debate. Again, we're tight for time, and I call first Christine Graham to be followed by Megan Gallagher. Up to 4 minutes. Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, frequently we become so accustomed to innovative policies in this Parliament that it's introduced, we forget to reflect on the impact and in some circumstances to celebrate the policies that they have on people for the better. The ban on smoking in public places, no prescription charges in Scotland, for example, and of course cashback for communities. Now, while the public will be aware of the smoking ban and free prescriptions, I'm sure most of the public are unaware of cashback for communities, mainly because it doesn't affect them overtly, though it does have an impact on their communities and the quality of life, not only for those communities, but for the many individuals who benefit from these programmes. So I welcome the debate and the Labour amendment, and I suggest to Russell Finlay, I found a very interesting contribution, following the points he made, he puts forward solutions, if he can, to better recovery of proceeds. We all want to see that, although I appreciate the cross-border and international aspects raised by my colleague Keith Brown. Now 15 years old, in that time it's distributed £150 million to good causes. Many are in my own constituency of Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale, to which I'll come shortly. I was reminded of this recently when visiting the YMCA hub in Pennycook at the inauguration of RUTS, that's an unfortunate name, it's the Rural and Urban Training Scheme, the project there in partnership with the YMCA. That's one of the partner organisations in this scheme. It has received for 2023-2026 target to reach 400 activities for young people. Now, in this Scottish Borders, a total so far in 2008-2021 of over 2 million was distributed, covering over 100,000 activities. And in Midlothian, in the same period, over 1.5 million for 46,000 plus activities. This is not money that's to be dismissed. But back to RUTS at the YMCA in Pennycook. Using the grant facilities there, which had become underused and were in financial difficulties as a consequence, that has been rescued and in the right way. I saw the boxing ring and I had a go with the gloves on a punch bag. I will not disclose whose image I mentally projected on it, though I will do if I get the right donation for this, the YMCA. But then I went on to look at the motorbikes, where young people from 14 to 24 can learn about maintenance. And there are other projects that they can engage with to give them some sense of direction. Young people may self-refer there, be recommended, say, by social work or schools. And many and most are young people who are disengaged for a range of reasons from the, we call it in quotes, traditional routes, close quotes, through education and so on. It builds self-confidence and a sense of personal achievement, which can lead to apprenticeships, work, further education, but most importantly is centred on that individual. In the Borders, we have Tweeddale Youth Action and TD1, both recipients of funds, and in Gorebridge, the Guides, and in Gala Shields, the Boys Brigade, all receiving funding support. There are many more from large to modest projects. The purpose is always to help young people not to get back on track, but find the track which suits them towards a fulfilling and positive life, whether diverting from prosecution or intervening, we hope, far earlier. Helping them to help themselves before that becomes out of reach. What better application of the proceeds of criminal activity? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. I now call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Evelyn Tweed. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the many interesting aspects of our roles as MSPs is learning about incentives that bring cash back to our local communities. And for me, I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate on a subject that I do not usually voice in this Parliament, and that's how governments reinvest dirty money obtained through organised crime. Now, I'm not the only MSP in this chamber who wants to see this government get tougher on organised crime. And we've already heard from our Crime Watch champion, Russell Finlay, who since his election has made sure that tackling crime is at the forefront of discussions in this chamber. The Cashback for Communities scheme has the potential to do a lot of good for young people across Scotland. £130 million of reinvestment from the Proceeds of Crime Act is not to be scoffed at, and I know that this money goes directly to young people at risk of turning to a life of crime. Prevention is key when trying to protect young people from a life of crime, and I will always support incentives that are youth-led and targeted in areas where crime rates are higher. It is my understanding that the latest round of funding is for projects aimed to deliver a range of trauma-informed and person-centred services, which includes young people more likely to be involved in antisocial behaviour. And given the rise in antisocial behaviour in our town centres and high streets, I'm sure that business owners and those concerned about antisocial behaviour will be reassured that funding is being used to reduce this problem many of us are experiencing just now in our communities. And it's not just these incentives where money is being directed. The Moving Forward Plus project is delivered by National Autistic Society Scotland's Prospects team and is funded by Cashback for Communities. It supports disadvantaged autistic young people on a path to becoming more engaged and happier citizens, reducing the chances of either becoming victims or perpetrators of crime by recognising that each autistic young person has individual needs and aspirations. And the project has two routes, one for children aged 10 to 15 who are not engaged with school education, and another for autistic young adults aged 16 to 25 who are not in training, employment or education. And the support involves helping individuals better understand their autism, exploring their strengths and developing suitable strategies to help them become more resilient. And I do believe, Presiding Officer, that is a wonderful project that will benefit so many young people. And I've got a stat here that since 2020, the project itself has supported more than 93 young autistic people. So going back to my point earlier on, this scheme has the potential to do a lot of good. But I think we can also recognise that the scheme isn't perfect. And I do hope that the government will realise that more can be done to increase cash back for our communities. Crime should pay. And what better message to send to communities that this government backs them? Because as it stands, the money recovered from the Proceeds of Crime Act does not match the wealth accumulated by criminals in Scotland. An example of this has been pointed out. It was reported in 2022 that £11 million worth of dirty money had not been paid back. That's £11 million of money that could be directly invested back into our communities. But I do appreciate that that is, of course, subject to review at this point in time. So I think the government must think how it can recuperate as much money as possible from organised crime. As Russell Findlay said, the scheme needs an audit to maximise the amount of money that could be reinstated back into our communities. Presiding Officer, time is tight today, and I mentioned prevention earlier on. It is key, and investment is needed to ensure that effective programmes are rolled out. So my calls today is for this government to get tougher on crime and to make sure that prevention is at the heart of Cashback for Communities. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. I now call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Claire Baker. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland has committed to getting it right for every child and creating an equal society where every child and young person in Scotland can reach their full potential. To create an equal society, there must be equal access to opportunity. Cashback for Communities funding is allowing organisations to remove barriers to access and strengthen communities. We've heard from the Minister about the £130 million spent through Cashback for Communities since its inception, supporting around 1.3 million young people. And I want to provide a local example from my constituency to highlight the huge difference that even a small proportion of these funds can make at local level. Barry Hughes told me about the impact Cashback for Communities funding makes for Raplock Scouts. This group, as well as others in Stirling, including Bray Head, receive Cashback for Communities funding through Scout Scotland. Barry started Raplock Scouts in 2019, and at the beginning he only had 8 beavers, but it's been so successful that he now has over 60. Scouts and groups like it give so much to young people and their communities, and research has found that young people involved in Scouts are learning more skills, volunteering more often, and contributing to a kinder, more cohesive society. Children in poverty face damaging stigma that erodes their confidence and their mental health. Those in areas of deprivation face barriers accessing activities that could build their confidence and their life skills. Cashback for Communities funding has allowed Raplock Scouts to remove barriers for many who otherwise would struggle to participate especially during this cost of living crisis. The uniform alone is quite expensive at £21 for a scout shirt, but using Cashback for Communities funds, Ratlock Scouts have provided all of the uniforms to their members. Many scout groups ask for parents and caregivers to pay upfront for a term of meetings, to book activities in advance, and to purchase materials. But Barry told me that the £35 a term quickly adds up, especially when families have two or three children attending. Funds from Cashback for Communities provides a pot of money to be used for upfront bookings and allows Ratlock Scouts to operate on a pay-as-you-go basis. This small change has made a massive difference, and it's also allowed Ratlock Scouts to fund camping trips. They've taken two trips this year already to Invertrossachs by Loch Venicar, which is a beautiful area in my constituency. And for lots of their members, these are the only trips away they will get each year. The young people have got so much from this, and without this funding, many would not be able to enjoy these opportunities or participate at all. Investment in these experiences for young people is also preventative spend for our justice system. Scout Scotland is only one of the many partners of Cashback for Communities making real positive change in my constituency. Presiding Officer, with nearly £2 million being spent across Stirling since 2008, the proceeds of crime being reinvested is having a transformational impact, and it's really strengthening local communities. This is a real force for good, and I echo the Minister's commendation and look forward to what the future will bring for this initiative. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Claire Baker to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cashback for Communities programme has reinvested the proceeds of crime into our communities, supporting over 1 million young people, including many in Mid Scotland and Fife. In Burnt Island, the Shell Twilight Initiative with Scottish Sports Futures delivered weekly indoor physical activity sessions alongside wellbeing and mental health advice and speakers. Scottish Sport Futures have also supported young people from Stirling and Fife in a residential trip to Auchengillen Outdoor Centre, which for many of them is their first time away staying from home. Bernardo's have provided the 8-week Fit to Work Employability programme, which has helped build confidence as well as support participants in securing qualifications and work placements. As others have said, the programme has been running now for 15 years, with the most recent phase receiving over 150 applications, although only 29 organisations will benefit from the round of grants. Clearly, there's a huge demand for government support, particularly in the current circumstances. But while the programme for government commits to continue to reinvest money through Cashback for Communities, does this have to just mean more of the same? Or is this an opportunity to evaluate and expand the process and look at how well it's delivering its aims? While we, of course, welcome the hard work of the partner organisations, this does not mean that there is not room for improvement. It is welcome that there are some organisations new to this phase, including Star Catchers Productions, who are going to work with Gingerbread and Fife to deliver creative play opportunities for families through the Cashback for Young Parents programme. But many of the organisations funded are national bodies, some of whom are receiving significant proportions of the available finance. And we need to be confident this funding is delivering local impact in communities across the whole of Scotland, and that it's not just having the unintended consequence of bids from more specialised local organisations from missing out. Perhaps the key to this is increasing the overall funding, but I'm also interested to find out more about how the programme is being evaluated and how it could be improved. While there are employment programmes and early intervention programmes, and I do recognise there's a need for these, I feel we should see a greater prioritisation on diversionary schemes and activities to engage those who are most at risk of offending. For a number of years, Kingdom Off-Road Motorcycle Club has been working to reduce illegal and antisocial motorcycling in Fife communities, and including through the Gears Youth Initiative, targeted at those furthest from mainstream education and most at risk of antisocial behaviour. Fife Council recently agreed to put funding towards the project, which has not been able to attract money from the Cashback Communities Fund this year. I have worked with Kingdom Off Road for a number of years, and I have seen how their activity has grown and how they can have a meaningful impact. On a recent visit, where I even got on an off-road bike, we discussed how, I'll not tell more of that story, but we discussed how proceeds of crime, aside from cash, can be used to benefit these types of programmes. For example, where bikes are confiscated by police, could we look at more systematic ways to ensure they can be then utilised by organisations like Kingdom Off-Road rather than being auctioned or destroyed? And while Cashback for Communities is deemed unique to Scotland, there are similar schemes elsewhere. Merseyside Police have a community cashback fund which is used to prevent crime and antisocial behaviour, offering diversion from criminal gangs. Essex Police work with a local community foundation to provide grants to charities and volunteer organisations. And in North Wales, the Police and Community Trust has supported initiatives across the region since 1998 that improve people's quality of life by reducing crime and fear of crime, using cash which is seized from criminals and recycled for the public good. So there are opportunities to share knowledge and good practice across the UK, and I would encourage the Minister to engage in those discussions. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much, President Officer. First, I'd like to remind the Chamber, with regards to my register of interest as an ambassador for the Ocean Youth Trust for Scotland. President Officer, I'm pleased to be speaking in this debate as I believe the Cashback for Communities programme is something that this Parliament should be certainly very proud of now in its 15th year. The programme is unique to Scotland, demonstrating the Scottish Government's commitment to supporting our young people to live full, healthy lives and also to address some of the underlying causes of crime. And as per the motion in front of us today, the Cashback for Communities reinvests money recovered from the proceeds of Crime Act 2002 into positive activity, which supports young people's well-being, which also helps to build their confidence and skills. Since its inception, the programme has committed £130 million to support around 1.3 million young people across Scotland, including in my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency. The Cashback for Communities delivers many things for young people, including diversionary activities and also community-led opportunities. And the two projects in particular in my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency that I want to touch upon are the Greenock Morton Community Trust and also the Ocean Youth Trust for Scotland. And I want to thank Beatrice Wishart for her comments regarding OIT Scotland earlier. I'm here to be proud of both organisations and the outstanding work that they do. They engage with a wide range of young people, including those requiring diversion activities, carers, younger people, younger children getting active, to name just three examples. Inverclyde is extremely fortunate to actually have both of these organisations, and they enrich my community. And I've sponsored events for both of them in the Parliament before to help more people realise what they do, and their excellence remains high. As Cashback for Communities has shown, the diversionary work actually does help to reduce antisocial behaviour by focusing on prevention, early intervention and also improving the life chances of young people. And sadly, children and young people from deprived backgrounds are at a greater risk of sadly being involved in antisocial behaviour. Now, that doesn't preclude it from occurring in affluent neighbourhoods or children and young people from more privileged backgrounds being involved. But this highlights, though, the flexibility of the approach with the cashback programme that actually is deployed. However, particularly in areas of deprivation, it's important that projects funded by the programme focus on delivering a range of trauma-informed and also person-centred services and activities. And this demonstrates why the programme is so valuable, as it provides vulnerable and disadvantaged young people with access to opportunities to help them achieve their potential. Many of these activities are things that these younger people would never, ever have dreamt of doing before. Now, these opportunities sometimes are not actually afforded elsewhere either. This is where the OIT Scotland in particular excel. Now, they support young people from across Scotland to take part in life-changing residential voyages with the aim of helping them develop new skills and move them onto positive destinations. In 2018, I touched upon the point I'd raised, spoke about earlier, that I actually highlighted with OIT. They have been in the Parliament before. In 2018, the event was celebrating their On Course with Cashback programme. That involved the Cashback Communities groups embarking on sailing voyages, including people from Inverclyde Academy and the young people from the Port Glasgow iZone. It was certainly very much a pleasure and a privilege to invite the charity, its partners and some of the young people involved in the programmes to actually come to the Scottish Parliament to showcase the wonderful work of OYT Scotland. OYT Scotland has been a cashback for communities partner for three phases, and I'm delighted that from 2023-26 they will receive £475,000 for their On Board with Cashback project, which expects to work with 248 young people over this period. Presiding officer, I could go on. I know time is short and I'm about to close, so thank you very much. And certainly, with this cashback programme, it certainly does help change lives for many people across the country. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Keith Brown.
Thank you, presiding officer. I welcome this motion and share its commendation of the Cashback for Communities programme. Over its 15-year history, it has developed to become more sensitive to the needs of young people, families and communities across Scotland, including those in the North East. It acknowledges that there aren't two watertight compartments of people, one criminals and one victims. Injustices, inequalities and experiences of trauma impact on individuals in ways that can leave them harmed or harming, and often both. It recognises that crime of all kinds has the most devastating effects on the most marginalised communities, on people living in poverty and in areas of multiple deprivation. And it realises that intergenerational trauma and adverse childhood experiences have a huge impact on who is most vulnerable to the behaviours and situations that we commonly describe as crime. Some of the most inspiring projects are those which share the creative arts to build young people's confidence, imagination, communication, and other skills. They include Cashback for Change, delivered by Y-Dance in Angus and Dundee, and the Move Forward project, delivered by Station House Media Unit, or SHMU, in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, developing skills in radio, film, and music. Other activities support people to develop skills that may help them find employment. Projects like Bernardo's Fit for Work, which operates in Aberdeen, Dundee, and now also in Murray. While many of these projects focus on those at risk of being brought into the criminal justice system, others address the needs of those already caught within its structures. That means supporting young people who have been incarcerated, helping them to build their well-being and develop essential skills in preparation for their release. The Cashback Passport project working in Polmont has helped young people in readiness for their lives after incarceration. And the Keeping Families Together project, delivered by the Sirenians in Montrose, helps young people in secure care to rebuild relationships and return to their family homes. While much of this work is delivered by large and well-known partners, it is equally important that the fund supports smaller grassroots initiatives too. So I was pleased to see that the Youth Work Fund, redistributed through YouthLink Scotland, has benefited local providers, including the Kiri Youth Project, Rock Solid Dundee, and Aberdeen Foyer, as well as enabling the Give Us a Break partnership pilot project in Dundee. I hope that this local aspect can be expanded in years to come, especially supporting those projects led or co-produced by young people themselves. Cashback for Communities is an encouraging example of what Scotland can do well within our devolved powers, but it is not a complete answer to the deep-rooted problems which it tackles. It works, as it should, with individual young people, their families and communities. But that work needs to be complemented by policies which address the structural causes of adverse childhood experiences and intergenerational trauma, causes that include child poverty, inequality, service and resource shortfalls. And it needs to be underpinned by robust and enforceable children's rights and by continued reform of a criminal justice system which too often punishes young people for their economic and social situations. And finally, its funding source sanctions certain kinds of crime, but does absolutely nothing to redress some of the most damaging harms, environmental, corporate, and institutional injustices that destroy health, happiness, and hope. I commend the programme, but I urge us also to look further and deeper to a shared future where, as well as giving back to communities, we can better protect them all, including the young people, in the first place. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Keith Brown to be followed by Ros McCall.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I start by thanking Siobhan Brown, no relation, for bringing this motion to the Chamber. I absolutely commend the work of Cashback for Communities, an organisation which uses money collected from the proceeds of crime to fund projects to support young people. And the motion rightly recognises the positive work of the organisation, as have many of the speeches in the Chamber so far today. But I'd like to try and address the underlying rationale behind the creation of Cashback for Communities. It is just one of a raft of Scottish Government measures that takes a preventative approach to crime by seeking to address the root causes of crime, in this case by addressing issues like social isolation, loneliness and peer pressure amongst young people. And the point is particularly pertinent given the scenes of irresponsible firework use, for example, we've seen across Scotland over the past week. And I'd urge all members, when we address these incidents, not to think only about the rules and regulations on the sale of fireworks, much of which lie with Westminster, but also about the underlying social factors that caused this behaviour in the first place. I don't disagree with some of the points that Maggie Chapman made, but I do think the greater harms that she's talking about have to be addressed in the context of the austerity years which we're going through. And Cashback for Communities has spent £130 million supporting around 1.3 million young people across Scotland since its creation 15 years ago, not least in my own constituency, where the funding has supported organisations like Play Alloa or Lawnsall Academy's School of Football. It's also worked closely with local groups like Connect Alloa or Oco Youth Community Improvement to deliver homelessness awareness projects, art sessions, sessions on alcohol and drugs awareness, and anti-vandalism projects over that 15-year period. And last year, I opened one of Cashback for Communities outreach events at Hawkill Community Association in Alloa, and that was an opportunity to celebrate what Cashback for Communities offers our young people, an opportunity to come together and to learn from each other in a young person-led environment. Of course, as the Chief Officer of Club Manager's Third Sector Interface, Anthea Coulter often makes the case, Club Manager could always benefit from further support, as could Dunblane and Bridge of Allen, from the programme to address local challenges that arise. And I know that she would welcome the opportunity to meet with myself and the Minister, and I'll write to the Minister on this, to discuss our local context. It would be wrong, though, to highlight the success that Cashback for Communities has had in achieving its dual goals of financial investment in our communities and preventing crime before it happens, without also highlighting the significant challenges that both of those goals face. And I refer, of course, again to the 14 years now of Westminster austerity, which has changed our communities beyond all recognition. And I'd suggest that it's very likely that that austerity has been a significant contributor to the very issues of loneliness, isolation and peer pressure amongst young people, despite the immense work of organisations supported by Cashback for Communities that work so hard to support our charities, social enterprise and voluntary groups as they support our young people. So while Cashback for Communities has made a significant difference to our society, not least in my own constituency, much of that hard work, both from the view of financial investment and from the viewpoint of addressing the root causes of crime, is under threat by the unwanted Westminster austerity forced on Scotland. And in closing, I would just reiterate the point I made, and I'm very grateful to Katie Clark for agreeing to write with me to the UK Government. The scope of this could be substantially expanded, as could its effect on families and communities in Scotland, if Westminster were to follow the same approach by bringing back some of the proceeds of crime to help communities, including those in Scotland which are affected by, for example, the drug trade coming through road and rail routes from England and the rest of the UK to Scotland. And notwithstanding that point, I would conclude by saying I quite agree there should be a review and people should satisfy themselves that the right criteria have been used for the awards. But just to say, I'm well aware there's very limited scope for ministers to direct these awards, but there's no harm at all in having a review, and I support the motion in the name of Siobhan Brown.
Thank you. And I call Ros McCall to be followed by Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to add my support to the Cashback for Communities programme and for the Scottish Conservative Amendment. I commend the scheme and recognise it has managed since 2008 to reinvest up to £130 million worth of money obtained through the proceeds of crime back into community projects. I also want to highlight the most recent round of cashback funding from March of this year, when £20 million has been pledged to be invested into projects that support young people into employment. And I note that this funding aims to deliver a range of trauma-informed and person-centric services, with a Cashback of Communities website stating that services and activities will be delivered for young people at risk of being involved in antisocial behaviour, young people impacted by adverse childhood experiences, for young people's health and mental health, and to support communities affected by crime. I also note my colleague Megan Gallagher highlighted Moving Forward Plus programme delivered by the National Autistic Society, but I think it's worth repeating that it supports disadvantaged autistic young people on the path to becoming more engaged citizens. This in turn reduces their chances of becoming victims or perpetrators of crime. So it'll be no surprise to everyone that I applaud the focus of this round of funding, and I'll be very interested in any information as to the outcomes of Phase 6 of this programme. Imagine what could be done if the full amount of confiscation orders were collected and if we could remove more dirty money from organised crime gangs. Presiding Officer, the latest data from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service states that currently there's more than £1.5 million worth of confiscation orders that are in arrears. Of the £19 million worth of orders being imposed over the last 5 years, £14 million has been paid off, leaving a staggering £5 million left outstanding and uncollected. And in 2022, it was also reported that over £11 million worth of dirty money had not been paid back. When you consider the good that this money can do, and the fact that this money is obtained by criminal processes, it should be imperative that we ensure the orders imposed are paid in full. It is also necessary that the confiscation orders are robust and fitting to the amount earned from the crime committed. I was shocked to hear of a case where a person, after selling fake luxury items such as watches, sunglasses, clothing and aftershave, totalling over £1 million, was only requested to repay £31,000, which is utterly ridiculous, and that the Crown Office has no issues with reducing the amount to be repaid after an appeal. Unfortunately, this sort of narrative makes a mockery of the system and only perpetuates a soft-touch approach to breaking the law, to swindling people out of their hard-earned money, and it seems to underscore that crime does pay, and it shouldn't. Surely it would be sensible to review the proceeds of the Crime Act so that we can look to recover more cash back from organised crime gangs and cunning, petty swindlers. Too many times, organised crime makes substantial sums of money, but authorities are unable to recover these ill-gotten gains or simply don't have the resources to fulfil the task. So more powers should be afforded so our justice system can go after the criminal gangs, apply appropriate penalties, and force payment in full. Presiding Officer, I will always stand up for trauma-experienced children and young people. And if there is a way we can redistribute funds to actively support positive change in the lives of our young people and help them thrive on to achieve their potential, then it will have my full support. So let's review the proceeds of Crime Act, update the serious organised crime strategy, and properly fund cash back into our communities. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Carol Mockin to be followed by Marie McNair.
Presiding Officer, it is right that consensus has been found in the Chamber today insofar as that the Cashback for Communities programme has been beneficial to our communities and that it must be continued in years to come to allow that impact to be felt and seen in our communities. The Proceeds of Crime Act delivered by a Labour government in 2002 paved the way for initiatives such as the Cashback for Communities programme to be introduced, and it is heartening to hear the impacts today from members. These funds are aimed at delivering positive futures for our young people, a legacy of a Labour government, and it is appropriate that this scheme continues to deliver for young people and that the scheme seeks to ensure positive destinations for young people. It is important, however, that we note the role of restorative justice in this debate today. Whilst the funds collected are reinvested in tackling antisocial behaviour initiatives, sporting activities and other positive programmes that we've heard, it should be highlighted that access to restorative justice practices can prevent crime and antisocial behaviour as well as reducing reoffending. Therefore, I would hope that the Scottish Government would support Labour's amendment this evening as one that makes an important addition to a motion rightly recognising the success of this programme. Presiding Officer, communities themselves tell us of the fear that they have that young people can turn to crime if investment opportunity and activity is lacking for our young people.
I'm sure many of the members in the Chamber today have discussed this worry with parents, carers and the wider community. I've attended many community councils or surgeries with local councillors on countless occasions, and this has brought to my attention time and time again. So yes, this programme has had success, and as other members have said, we should dig deep into this. Anything that we can do in addition with this fund would be helpful. But we do need further investment in our communities to act upon the real and serious concerns of those in our communities in the south of Scotland and beyond. In preparing for this debate, I noted several initiatives in my own region, as other members have, providing support to locally established groups such as the Scouts and the Girls Guides, helping with digital work, badges and general sport or culture activities. Things that can seem small, but as other members have said, these resources can be scarce for some families, but it's very impactful being able to do some of these trips or aways or activities. And some of our small Ayrshire communities, which are often isolated, these small steps can be a big help encouraging young people to participate in groups and clubs and engaging with the wider family. We are all aware, I'm sure, that often communities, particularly rural and isolated communities, talk about the lack of activities and facilities for young people in villages and how they feel this is linked to antisocial behaviour. Strengthening already existing groups in these communities can be helpful, and I think other members across the benches mentioned about these community groups, and perhaps we could look at how they can be supported. I'm sure the Minister would be able to comment on that. I do note with interest that organisations such as Aberlour have received some of the sums, and these groups are working at very grassroots levels, and they will be receiving funds in phase six, which I am pleased about. Presiding Officer, the local interest in supporting our young people and preventing crime exists. The benefits of this programme are clear. However, it needs to be matched with strong funding for local services to ensure our communities work for those most at risk of being caught up in the criminal justice system, and others have mentioned this. More needs to be done with regards to organised crime. People involved in organised crime can take millions of pounds in cash and assets, and we need to ensure this cash is seized and moved, and other members have spoken quite clearly about this.
Presiding Officer, in conclusion,
I support this reinvestment in our communities. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call Marie McNair, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over the last 15 years, the Cashback for Communities programme has played a crucial role in the lives of countless young people and communities across Scotland. And I welcome that over the next 3 years, phase six of the programme is expected to reach around 34,000 young people. Presiding Officer, in East Dunbartonshire, part of my constituency, over £1 million has been spent on over 40,000 activities from 2008 until now. In West Dunbartonshire, approximately £2.5 million has been spent on 44,000 activities. One of those who received funding was Includem, a Scottish charity that works with young people and families. In 2020, they were granted funding for cashback for a three-year project to provide an early intervention service in West Dunbartonshire for children and young people who were felt to be at risk of offending. In a recent report written by Matter of Focus, they discuss their findings after 3 years, and I think some of the figures reported by the young people speak for themselves. 91% of children and young people moving on from the project reported increased confidence, 94% said they felt more resilient, and 89% felt they maintained or improved their attendance in school. Now, this is valuable in helping us to understand the impact, but to add to this, here's a rather powerful statement from a police representative from year one. They stated that the majority of young people that have been referred are no longer coming to my attention for negative things. This is where the pattern of behaviour that they were displaying previously in the professional experience would have suggested the risk of escalation. As MSP covering part of West Dunbartonshire, I know fire setting continues to be an ongoing issue. It's also something that was brought to the attention of Includem. To tackle this issue, they set up meetings between young people, their Includem worker and the fire service. The young people gained a new understanding of the potential seriousness of fire-raising, the consequences of their actions and what this could mean for their future. And the workers have observed that those involved in the work appear to stop fire-setting. And that's hugely significant and very welcome. The impact of cashback extends well beyond just the individual it supports. It extends to the families too. Evidence from this project in Western Bartonshire has helped parents and carers to be in a better place for supporting the child in their care. But it doesn't stop there. It also extends to the wider community. And one of the most compelling aspects of cashback is that it allows communities to get involved and express the change they want to see. Inclusion's fire setting project was a key example of responding to something local residents were concerned about. For the families of young people who had been involved in fire raising, this will contribute to reduced pressure and worry and overall to a safer community in Western Bartonshire. This is just one case study amongst a vast amount of positive work being done, but it illustrates the success of this programme. The Scottish Government's cashback programme shows the power of effective governance, one that understands the importance of investing in our vulnerable young people. It underlines the Scottish Government's commitment to support young people to live full, healthy lives and address some of the underlying causes of crime. Young people are the future of our country, so cashback is not just an investment in our local community, but an investment in our future. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Pauline McNeill. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I do welcome this debate. It is some time, I think, since the Parliament actually discussed the Cashback for Communities programme. And I think it's really important, perhaps, maybe to start off with Russell Findlay's amendment, because, of course, the source of it is the money, whatever you want to call it, that's recouped from criminals, and to do something useful with that communities. An observation that I would make is that it's been some time since we used to get almost an annual report from what was the former Scottish Crime Drugs Enforcement Agency, who used to talk about what they'd captured. But since it was amalgamated into the Gartcross campus, I kind of feel that the visibility of the capture of crime has almost disappeared. And I would make some pleadings to ministers that perhaps we should ask Police Scotland to think about doing that again. I have no idea how successful Police Scotland have been, but I would say maybe 5-6 years ago, I was much clearer. The Cashback for Communities programme, I agree with all members here, is a brilliant concept introduced by a Labour government, as Carol Malkin points out, but continued by the current Scottish government, unique to Scotland. So we should all be proud of that, returning money gained through criminal activity back to communities through targeted investment for the purpose of preventing antisocial behaviour, supporting well-being, building confidence and skills for young people, and restorative justice programmes we all agree have been beneficial to communities. And Mary McNear addressed this in her contribution about how important that actually can be. But as Claire Baker says, and I agree with this, perhaps it's time for a refocus on where the money's going, and particularly an evaluation. Because some of the figures I'm going to quote, as others have done, I'm not really sure overall whether or not that sounds like a lot of investment, and I'm not really sure what it's achieving, which I know it's achieving a lot, but I think to get some evaluation is really, really important. So we know that the programme has provided 2.5 million activities for people since its inception. 75% of young people involved with these activities from the most deprived communities in Scotland. And in my own region of Glasgow, over 250,000 activities since 2008. And in this year alone, 2022-2023, we've seen £1.5 million provided to 4,500 types of activities. So the programme brings invaluable opportunities, benefits to children, young people and families and communities as part of its aims, and the positive impact, which undeniable, I do think, should be evaluated. With phase 6 of the programme underway until March 2026, we must ensure that the greatest amount of this revenue from criminal activity is seized, and we must ensure that it is reinvested. And I think the Minister said in her opening statement that we won't see the details of Phase 5 until the end of the year. And I was sort of wondering to myself, maybe we should have been debating after we get a chance to see that. But perhaps there could be some focus on that when that's available. So we do certainly need a justice system that ensures the prevention of crime and better outcomes for those at risk of involvement in crucial parts of addressing criminal behaviour. And it's with this in mind, I do want to stress the need for making sure some of this money does go into youth offending services. If I could just mention Dick Stewart Services, which works across Scotland, has recently had its funding threatened, but it has a tremendous record on supporting young male offenders leaving prison, and they've had top marks for the Care Inspectorate, but yet we may see the closure of the service. So there's one example of where maybe there's need to be a broadening out of investment to ensure we're not losing existing services. A new grant recipient for Phase 6, which is the Ventures Trust, is a prime example of the work that we should be investing in. And last year, 47% of the Venture Trust's 688 participants were at the time involved in the Scottish justice system. Their Living Wild programme supports both men and women on community payback, while their Inspiring Young Futures programme supports young people struggling with unemployment who are involved in offending antisocial behaviour, amongst other things. Through activities aiming to build aspirations and self-confidence, develop employability skills and improve health and well-being, amongst a quarter of these participants have reported at least one positive outcome in their life. And whether that could be educational achievements, getting voluntary or work experience, referral to another service, or even something more personal like gaining access to their own children, ultimately reducing their risk of antisocial and criminal behaviour is what we're aiming for here. For young women in particular, strong relationships, self-confidence and financial security are all key to avoiding taking part in antisocial and criminal behaviour. Also receiving funds this year is Strengthening Communities for Race Equality Scotland, who work with ethnic minority young people aged from 11 to 24, and a significant number of their activities centre on reducing antisocial and criminal behaviour in approximately 450 young people, for example, working with Police Scotland to establish trust between communities and law enforcement. Just in my conclusion, 30 seconds, Presiding Officer, it struck me that when Ros McCall was speaking earlier, is that perhaps a review of the Proceeds of Crime Act might be something which is in order, because some of the figures quoted do lead to questions. And I do understand it's a matter of evidence what can be proved, but we shouldn't be complacent about a really important act, Proceeds of Crime Act. We need to make sure prosecutors in court have the necessary tools in law to ensure that they can get the maximum amount of people who break the law and ensure that the return on that is actually it relates to the amount of money in the first place in which they broke the law. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Sharon Dowie. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate has been interesting and worthwhile. This Parliament doesn't spend enough time debating the justice system or how to tackle the crime that is rife in so many communities. So I welcome any opportunity we get to focus on the important issues. Today's government motion raises the positives of the Cashback for Communities scheme. I'd also like to use this opportunity to discuss some of the issues with the scheme and the wider justice system, which have also been highlighted in some of the contributions we've heard today. Turning to the motion, we agree with it. The Scottish Conservatives want to thank all those involved in the Cashback for Communities scheme for their commitment and hard work. It's a successful programme that delivers benefits for many young people and families across the country, and we've heard that in lots of contributions this afternoon. We firmly believe that the money which criminals gain by inflicting pain on communities and vulnerable people should be reinvested back into the communities so it can finally do some good. We welcome that £130 million has been reinvested from the proceeds of crime so far, and we believe the vast majority of that funding has gone towards great projects and causes which help those communities most affected by crime. But while we all support the principle behind the scheme, we would be doing communities a disservice if we didn't look at improving it, and this scheme could be stronger.
We would support a review into the Proceeds of Crime Act, and that was mentioned by Rose McCall, so that more dirty money can be recovered from organised crime gangs. The law needs more teeth to go after illegally obtained money, particularly since nearly £5 million worth of money ordered to be confiscated is still outstanding over the last 5 years.
Yes. Keith Brown.
Sharon Dow for taking intervention. Just say, given what she said about trying to, I think, increase the money that's taken in from this, would she be willing to write with myself and Katie Clark to the UK government to say that for crimes perpetrated down south which have an impact in Scotland, the UK government could usefully introduce the same cashback for communities initiative, and that would raise money for communities in Scotland? Would she support that letter?
Sharon Dowie.
Thanks for the intervention. Mr Brown and Ms Clark have been in the justice section for a lot longer than I have, so I'd want to see more details on that. But at the moment, all the money from proceeds of crime in Scotland do come back into Scotland, so I would want to look at it in more detail first. So to continue, they managed to hold on to a great deal of the money they accumulated while committing crimes. They exploit loopholes in the system. They hide money effectively. Most of us could point to examples in our communities where a crime gang continues to control major businesses even after the police have made convictions. If you speak to experts on crime, especially frontline officers, they can point out large homes and expensive properties owned by individuals with clear connections to organised crime. We believe Scotland's police force needs more resources so it can target operations at the worst gangsters who reap the rewards of their offences. Frontline officers want to go after these criminals, but they simply don't have the funding and support from the government to do so as it stands. The SNP's planned cuts to Police Scotland will undoubtedly make the situation worse. It's unacceptable for the government to come here today and speak about the benefits of tackling organised crime while not mentioning police cuts. Can I make some more progress? Because there's a lot of contributions that I want to get through. Thanks. Crime gangs have already been emboldened by weaknesses in the SNP's justice system, which so often puts the rights of criminals before victims. But if the SNP continue with their plans to cut more of police budgets, then criminals will get away with even more. The Proceeds of Crime Act will recoup less money. The Cashback for Communities programme will not be as successful as it has been, and in turn, more vulnerable young people will be preyed on by criminals. It's a vicious circle that the SNP government can prevent. Our police force needs investment. And to go even further, this government needs to give organised crime the attention it deserves. At the moment, this government spends far too much time and resources on its own political priorities, not on the issues that really matter to working people, like how we stop the damage caused to communities by drug dealers and criminals, and how we prevent disgusting attacks on emergency workers like we saw this week. In Edinburgh, officers made clear that while those attacks were carried out by young people, police believed they were encouraged by adults with a violent history. The government talks the talk on organised crime. In their most recent organised crime strategy, the foreword said, and I quote, "Organised crime remains a serious threat to us all, and we pay for it every day, either directly as victims or indirectly by paying for the services, such as police, prosecution, the health services that are required to respond to it." We couldn't agree more, but the SNP don't back up those words with action. Their weak approach to justice lets criminals away with crimes. I'm just going to touch on some of the contributions. So Russell Finlay raised the case of a single drug dealer who made nearly the same amount as the entire 15-year spend in cashback for communities. So again, I do think we need to look at the Proceeds of Crime Act to see how we can get more money from people that are committing these crimes. Rose McCall also touched on that as well. Megan Gallagher spoke of Moving Forward Plus, the National Autistic Society, how it's helping people get on a path and making them more resilient. Katie Clark mentioned the need for greater clarity on the matrix for evaluating the scheme. It's unclear how organisations are chosen for the scheme, and we all want better outcomes.
for young people. So I would agree with Katie Clark in that. When we need to more support, more clarity in how this is measured would be welcomed. I'm going to run out of time here, so I'm afraid lots of good contributions from other members as well. But finally, while we don't always agree on the government's overall approach to justice, can I thank the Minister for bringing forward this debate so we can look at how to improve the system. And I hope she will keep an open mind about improvements, because if we want the Proceeds of Crime Act to continue taking money from criminals, if we want the Cashback for Communities programme to continue to help good local projects, then the justice system must be tougher. Thanks for taking
this. Thank you. And I call on Siobhan Brown to wind up. Up to 9 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank everyone that's taken part in today's debate and shared their positive experiences of the Cashback for Communities programme and its 15 years of benefiting young people, families and communities. As I said at the start, the Cashback for Communities is unique to Scotland and demonstrates innovation, partnership and the importance on why we must invest in our young people. We should acknowledge that most young people are not involved in antisocial behaviour and involvement in the justice system. However, we should also recognise that some young people sadly don't get the opportunities of a good start in life that we would want them to. The Cashback program helps to address the inequality by making high value and early interventions to provide a wide range of support, activities and opportunities for children and young people, all of whom should be given the same chances to thrive. I think, if I may, Presiding Officer, I want to address quite a few of the comments that's come up today, because I know there was quite a bit to cover. First of all, I think, Russell Finlay, in your contribution, and I think across the Chamber, I think every single person would want to see an increase in the crime funds go into initiatives such as the Cashback, and I don't think anyone would disagree with that. The Proceeds of Crime Act 2002 provides a criminal confiscation of civil recovery of the financial benefit derived from criminal activity, but it also contains the principal money laundering legislation throughout the UK, which is reserved. So the Proceeds of Crime Act is a complex mix of both reserved and devolved matters, so it's something that we're not going to be able to resolve today. So the Scottish Government has responsibility for leading on the proceeds of crime and the legislative matters, but due to the complex area of it being resolved and devolved competence. But we will continue to monitor the need to strengthen the legislation to further detect, defer and also disrupt organised crime so that we can increase criminal funds to go into initiatives like the Cashback. But if I could also just go back to Russell Finlay's wanting to know about serious organised crime. Disrupting organised crime and diverting individuals away from organised crime remains a priority for the Scottish Government. A refreshed serious organised crime strategy was published in February 2022, and while the aims and the objectives remain broadly the same, Options for Change has focused on strengthening its links between intelligence and tasking, making better use of data and supporting efforts to improve collaboration across all sectors to combat the constantly evolving challenges that serious crime organisations do pose. The Serious Crime Organised Task Force Progress Report is due to be published later this month. I'll move on to, if I may, Katie Clark's contributions. Just about, and I know that Carol Mockin brought this up as well, about restorative justice. We remain committed to having restorative justice services available throughout Scotland. The needs and voices of persons harmed must be central to the process, and services must be safe, consistent and evidence-led, trauma-informed and of a high standard. The pandemic obviously slowed things down, and with progress in initial development work was identified the complexities, and we'll need to do further exploration there, but we are committed to taking the time to resolve these issues and develop a safe and a robust system, and work is underway with partners across the justice system to do this. One of the things that Katie Clark also asked is the criteria for phase six. They had four main aims, and for the diversion was for the diversion away from antisocial behaviour, the provision for positive activity and support for wellbeing and building confidence and skills. And I know that there was an exceptionally high number of applicants with 157 bids which were received, seeking over £80 million in funding. And these bids had to be subject to a robust panel assessment process. And in the end, there was only 29 that were successful partner organisations.
due to evaluation, which I think Claire Baker, Pauline McNeill and Katie Clark did raise. As I said in my opening speech, the full evaluation will be due this year, and it will be for members to have a look at that from the last phase. The cashback programme... Yes?
Christine Graham.
Could I be so bold as to ask the Minister to make her own personal evaluation by visiting the RUTS programme at Pennycook YMCA I referred to in my speech?
Minister.
I'd be happy to. Thank you, Presiding Officer. The programme, the cashback programme also provides opportunities for young people who have engaged with the justice system to develop the skills needed to make a more positive life choice and to turn their lives around. The Scottish Government's Justice Analytical Service evidence-based report published in 2018 on understanding childhood adversity, resilience and crime sites, building resilience into children and young people, their families and communities as crucial to reducing crime and victimisation. Direct feedback from cashback participants has shown that one-to-one support and guidance from trusted and experienced mentors and staff working in cashback projects is highly valued. Young people have told us that this approach has helped them to make better life choices that have changed their lives and changed all their relationships. A targeted approach that cashback projects takes to improve the outcomes for young people who have experienced poverty and disadvantage has endured the test of time. The cashback program has contributed to support and grow the evidence base around resilience and protective interventions. The program continues to support young people to develop pro-social behaviour and good social skills, be positive about the future and develop good self-esteem, develop positive engagement with learning, with school, and improve and develop positive connections with their peers, be involved with positive organisations, activities, sport, and build positive attachments and role models. And it has been a truly remarkable 15 years of progress. Since 2008, the program has supported over 1.3 million young people in Scotland. And no one could have foreseen the intense challenges of the pandemic and what would mean interrupted lives of our young people. Despite all of this, the Phase 5 cashback partners were able to overcome the multiple challenges to ensure that they could continue to support young people during some really dark days. And I commend and I thank them for that and their continued dedication to support the young people in their projects. The Cashback for Communities programme, since it started 15 years ago, has gone from strength to strength. Phase 6 has a stronger evidence-based focus on providing targeted support and helping to address some of the underlying causes of antisocial behaviour and crime. The evidence continues to show the correlation between the areas of deprivation, adverse childhood experiences, unhappy experiences of school and poor mental health as reasons why children and young people may fail to reach their full potential. Our learnings from Phase 5 show that poor mental health amongst children and young people has been exacerbated by the pandemic, and that demand for support through the cashback programs has increased. Our cashback partners have taken steps to ensure that they have the trauma-informed workforce needed to deal with the often most complex needs of the young people who they seek to support. That is why Phase 6 has a stronger focus on helping participants to improve their health, mental health and well-being, and that is why the support on offer through Cashback Phase 6 includes provision of trauma-informed and person-centred support for children, young people and their families. Cross-cutting policies are needed to identify and support families, children and their families at risk of early adversity at the earliest stage possible, and I look forward to seeing how we can better those connections. For example, the cashback program directly supports one of the First Minister's key missions of tackling poverty and protecting people from harm. Young people and their families who live and have grown up in poverty are the main target group for cashback projects. Phase 6 projects are also asked to identify families that may need further support and link them up to local support services, such as assessing social security benefits, free school meals and school clothing grants or food banks. Our vision for justice remains to deliver a just, safe, resilient Scotland and commits to working with our partners to ensure that people are less likely to be victims of crime, especially from deprived communities. And this involves community-based project work with young people to prevent harmful behaviour. Earlier this week, we published a 3-year delivery plan setting out the key areas of work within the justice sector, aligned to the aims set out with the vision of justice, which include the work on cashback, which I have been talking about today. Presiding Officer, I hope members will join with me in congratulating all the Phase 5 partners who work and reflected in the 2022-2023 Impact Report. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on cashback for communities. It's now time to move on to the next item for business.